Welcome to the Cyber Kuranku podcast.
So welcome to the podcast. My guest today is a free software advocate, Debian developer and admin of various free software initiatives. Welcome to the podcast, Pirate Praveen.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for inviting me. Happy to be here.
Okay, so would you like to explain to the people listening to this podcast what is free software and why you advocate for it?
Okay, so free software is about freedom of every computer user, like freedom to use the software, freedom to share the software, freedom to improve the software. Okay, so these freedoms are important, you know, as a society and as an individual, or even as a, you know, as a country, so that we can be self-reliant, you know, for like in technology. Otherwise, we would be, you know, at the mercy of big corporations like Microsoft, Google, Adobe, etc. So the free software actually, you know, keeps us in control. Like, the software is in our control, and if it's not free software, what happens is, we are actually, you know, controlled by the software, because the people who develop the software, they have complete control over the software.
Okay, so what do you mean by a free software? Like, what is the criteria for a free software? I don't understand the concept entirely.
Okay. So I think the simplest way to tell, I think, like I said, if the software is controlled by the users, that is free software. But if the users are controlled by the software, as in the users, you know, don't have any option to, you know, change the software that they use, then that is a proprietary software.
Okay. So how did you get into this movement?
Okay. Yeah. Before I explain that, I would probably add one more thing. Then many people would be, you know, wondering that, you know, I'm not a software programmer, you know, why does it matter whether I can, you know, modify the software or not? The thing is that, you know, whether like you have a cycle or maybe you have a car, you know, you don't really know, you know, how to repair that maybe. But then, you know, you have an option to take your cycle or a car to a, you know, mechanic and get it repaired. In case of software, like, you don't really have that option. For example, if you have Microsoft Windows, you know, only Microsoft can actually fix that. You cannot even take the software to, you know, anyone else to ask, like, can you fix this?
So for example, even Apple is an example for that, right?
Yeah, Apple also.
So my next question is that how did you start, how did you hear about the free software movement, and when did you start participating in it?
So I heard about free software, like, you know, vaguely in newspapers. I think it was around 99-2000 sometime, where, you know, I think Matribhumi and all, they used to have a corner, like one column for tech related, you know, articles. And then there was this article about Linux. So I was just curious. I heard this name, but then I actually, you know, got in touch with, or, you know, got an opportunity to see or try it when I joined engineering at NIT Calicut. At that time, it was REC, Regional Engineering College. So when I joined at REC Calicut, like in the main computer center, we had, you know, free software based systems. So I got a chance to, you know, use that, and then slowly, like, I got intrigued, and then, you know, there were some seniors who helped, you know, to understand how it is different and stuff like that. Then I also read more about it on the internet. That's how it all started.
The problem with, for example, I use many social media sites like Facebook and Instagram, and you advocate people to boycott these the social media. So if you boycott Facebook or social media, how do you interact with other people? Like, because it's very hard, right?
Yeah, it's definitely not an easy thing to do. I do call people on the phone still, and I also contact them via, SMS. And many people, like in the free software group, or even, the people that I close work with, they already use, free software platforms like Quixie, Element, or Conversations, XMPP or Matrix Protocol. And then I think Debian, where I contribute the most, we use email still as our main, communication medium.
So let's talk about your politics. You were involved with a group known as the Pirate Party of India. How did that come about to be, and how were you introduced to pirate politics?
Yeah, so the actual name is Indian Pirates. It used to be called the Pirate Party of India when we started. It was some years back. But then some kind of, like, it became inactive and, it couldn't continue. Then some of us who were there in Pirate Party of India, we created a new group called the Pirate Movement, which also didn't really, become sustainable due to different reasons. And then Indian Pirates was started as a third attempt. So this is our, third attempt for creating a, pirates organization. And I think the motivation came, during the, Anna Hazare's, India Against Corruption movement. And people were actually, protesting on the ground. A lot of people were inspired. So I thought, or I realized that, if there is someone there to inspire people, or provide a credible option, people would join you. But then I felt, the movement created by Anna Hazare, it was very, the foundation was very weak, as in, they were just focusing on corruption, and it is kind of just, probably symptom rather than, the real reason for all the problems. So I felt, they were not really going in depth. But then since, they were able to get people involved, I wanted to, create something that would really go in depth about issues, rather than just, talking about, superficial issues or just the symptoms. And that was the inspiration for starting the Pirate Movement. It was the Pirate Party of India.
What's your opinion about, like, that new IT laws? Do you think they are detrimental to our society?
Yeah, so I think you were talking about the IT rules 2021, like, it's called Intermediary Guidelines. And so it actually has three different sections. One that is dealing with, social media intermediaries. That could be, any platform like Twitter, WhatsApp, or Facebook, or like even the free software based platforms like Mastodon, Diaspora or Matrix. And then another part deals with digital news websites. And then the third part deals with the OTT platforms, Amazon, Netflix and stuff like that. So there are a lot of issues with that. Some of us are like directly involved in running free software based services, we also come as an intermediary. So we are actually challenging the rules as unconstitutional in the High Court of Kerala. We have already filed the petition. We got help from the Software Freedom Law Center India. We think, this is actually a violation of our constitutional rights. There are many provisions like, where an intermediary will have to, you know, trace the originator of a message. We think that is the violation of fundamental right to privacy. And then there are also, you know, requirements wherein, you know, you are supposed to, you know, remove content based on complaints from users. So that would seriously affect, you know, free speech, freedom of speech and expression. So I think overall, this is really a bad rules. And even the digital media one, it would increase, you know, censorship and government control over the digital news. So, yeah.
So I also wanted to ask this, in a free software, right? Like people control the software, right? So can you really enforce these rules? Like Facebook and WhatsApp can enforce these rules. But if everybody owns it, can you enforce a law like this in a free software?
Yeah, this is a interesting question. So, you know, what would eventually happen is, you know, probably they would make using free software or, you know, software that is not complying with these rules as illegal. So the effect is going to be, you know, people are, you know, law abiding will not be able to use, you know, free software or any software that would give them privacy. But then, you know, criminals and other people who don't really care about following the law, they can use any freely available software and they can continue enjoying privacy. So the irony is going to be, you know, all the criminals will have privacy, but then all the law-abiding citizens will lose their privacy.
Do you believe that people will adopt free software in the future? Because there's like a very lack of awareness among the general public, right, about free software. Even I am not really informed about free software and how it works actually. So do you think it will be widely adopted in the future?
I think, yeah, I agree that, you know, a lot of people are not really aware about free software. But then, you know, right now we don't really have, you know, a lot of, you know, monetary power, big, you know, we cannot do, you know, one full page ad like WhatsApp did, saying, you know, they're private, like they protect privacy and stuff like that. So only if, you know, people who actually, you know, understand this is important, they all start, you know, becoming more actively, you know, promoting, talking to people, convincing people why free software is important, then only it would happen. We always keep trying to, you know, reach out to more people, talk to people about free software. Like we, you know, we go to schools, colleges, you know, talk to people about free software. We organize events, seminars, you know. And last year we did a free software camp where, you know, we had a 3-month long online event where, you know, people could come and learn more about free software. And this year also we are planning to do that. So we always keep, you know, trying to promote it as much as possible. But then, you know, we don't really have the, you know, financial power of these companies and these corporations. So I think if more people would join in this effort, that would become, you know, like more effective.
Why do you think it is that the most common people are not concerned about their data? Like, even I am concerned a little bit about my data. I try my best, but I still use Facebook and Instagram mostly. So do you think, what are some actionable steps a common person can take to ensure more privacy?
Probably, you know, getting out of these networks or these platforms, you know, suddenly it's not going to be easy or, you know, really possible for a lot of people. But then, you know, maybe at least you should really, you know, start, you know, considering the free software and the decentralized alternatives where you have privacy and the freedom. So maybe, you know, start using them in parallel and then, you know, promote these other alternatives among, you know, your friends and, you know, other contacts. a lot of them doesn't really even know what are the problems, or you know, what there are, you know, better options available to communicate. Yes, we all, you know, need media to communicate, you know, keep in touch with people, you know, all those things. But then we do have, you know, free software options wherein, you know, without violating your privacy, you can actually, you know, do everything that you do using your proprietary services. But then I think, you know, initial time, like until, you know, these platforms reach a critical mass, at least till that time, you know, each of us who start to use, we will also have to be an activist and, you know, bring more people to these platforms at the same time. Yeah, I know it's a bit difficult thing, but I think, see, you know, the people say, you know, no pains, no gains. If it's something that, you know, it's in really in your interest, like, you know, interest as a person, interest as a, you know, society, interest as a country, you know, interest as a democracy to have, you know, people having privacy and freedom, then we also have to, you know, make some effort. So if more and more people are, you know, like come forward to make that effort, then we will be able to, you know, bring more people into it, at least, you know, to get a, you know, critical mass, or, you know, till some amount of users are there, we need to do this activism as well. But then once it has a critical mass, then probably, you know, we could you know, stop being an activist. But then, yeah, once you become an activist, you never stop being an activist. But yeah.
Okay, so how do you get involved in these FOSS communities and FOSS activism?
Okay, yeah, so, you know, if you are interested to, you know, learn and, you know, understand and, you know, read or like talk, like ask questions, you know, be like, you can join our you know, communities, and you can ask us any questions, or, you know, you can you can even, you know, listen to what people say. You can, you know, join campaigns that we run. So you know, we have this, you know, free software community of India group. So it's fsci.in. That is Free Software Community of India, fsci.in. You can come to our website, and then we have different options, like you can join our, you know, metrics room, where metrics is a free software based and decentralized messaging platform. Or we also have, you know, email based mailing list, and also web based forums, where, you know, you can just see all the discussions and even post using the, you know, post using your web browser. So okay, yeah, so I would say just you know, connect with us, start talking to us, and that would be a good point.
Okay, so you stood as an you stood in the elections last time, 2019, right?
Yeah, last Lok Sabha elections, and also the Legislative Assembly elections 5 years back.
Okay, so would you be active in politics in the future, or are you retiring from politics as of now?
Yeah, I would be active. I haven't really thought about retirement or anything. I'm still, you know, actively involved. And but the thing is that, you know, this is we are a very small group, and then, you know, it's not very easy for, you know, to get people involved. I think fundamentally, you know, a large number of people, or even majority of people, you know, they expect, you know, somebody else to solve their problems, you know. So if when people say, you know, like maybe Pinrai Vijayan or, you know, Modi, they come and say, you know, just vote for us and we will solve all your problems, you know, it's very convenient for people, you know. But what we are asking people is, you know, to be part of, you know, building an alternative, you know, it's not an easy thing. So most people would take, you know, easy and convenient option of just, you know, thinking that, you know, somebody else will fix things for us. So it has been very, very difficult to get more people involved. But then, yeah, we keep trying because, you know, I think this is very important. So I keep talking to new people, you know, talk to them. I explain what I do, how we do things, and, you know, hope more people joins.
This is my final question. Do you have anything to say to the people listening right now?
Yeah, I think, you know, see, the most important thing, if you really, you know, care about, you know, things happening in our society, things happen around us, if you think, you know, everything, like, all is not well, you know, there are a lot of things that are broken or that are not working for the people, then, you know, there is, you know, very less chance, you know, things would fix by itself or, you know, someone else will come and fix things for you. So you have to, you know, start, you know, thinking about, you know, the solution. You will have to, you know, talk to other people and, you know, work together and build a, you know, movement, and then, you know, as a collective, you know, try and solve the problems. I don't really think, you know, just waiting for other people to solve the problems is going to really work.
Okay, so with that, I am concluding this podcast. Thank you for coming as a guest. Would you like, where can people find you?
Yeah, so I am available on, you know, I use Element and like the Matrix protocol. So if you use the app, Element app, or there is also another app called Qxi, which would be probably easier for people to start because it's similar to how WhatsApp and all work. But then, you know, it's free software and decentralized. So you're not really locked into one single company or product. You can, you know, find me on Qxi or on Element, or like, you know, if you have not even started using these apps and, you know, you want to talk, you can, you know, talk to me. You can send me an email, praveen@debian.org. That is praveen@debian.org. That's my email. You will find me also on Mastodon. That is social.masto.host/@praveen.
Oh, okay, thank you.